Hey everybody, it's Stacy from Stacy Wells Artistry. I'm back. This is video number 2 in my Christmas little series thing. I'm back to painting and wanted to let y'all know. And so there's one video before this where I just kind of talk for a little bit and go over some things. And if you didn't watch that, you might want to pick that up first, because we're going to jump in here with these balls. To the extent that I want to show you a little bit about how I like to mix my paints for doing these. It's kind of the same way that I mix mine for doing a flip cup or basically anything else. Because I'm not one that changes my mix a whole bunch depending on what I'm doing. As long as it's an acrylic pour paint, it's generally the same kind of recipe. I don't alter that a whole lot. Now, if I'm doing a Sheliard or Sheliard, however you say it, you know what I'm talking about, house paint pour, then of course it's different. Everything's different, but you know that. So I've mixed up 3 of these. This right here, this is quinacrylone magenta, and that's Liquitex. And this right here is Artist Loft's, I think it's sap green. Yeah, sap green or deep green. Deep green. Artist Loft deep green. It's also got some deco art. I don't use these paints, the little craft paints, very often. And when I do, I always mix them with either Master's Touch or Liquitex or one of those, because these tend to have more water in them. If you've had problems with muddiness, if you've had problems with not getting really pretty cells, and you're just using craft paint, that may be why. I used to only use these in the beginning. I didn't know about these other ones, but better paint means better production. You know, Artist Loft, Master's Touch, Liquitex. I like these Master's Touch thick body acrylics. They say you can use less. I haven't found that to be necessarily true. I use the same amount, pretty much. Maybe just a little bit. But then there's Artist Loft. I love Artist Loft. I like all the Liquitex products. You know, you just got to play around and find what works for you. And so, let me give my disclaimer, first of all. If I say you need to, or you should, or anything, I probably don't mean to say that, because you have to experiment with this stuff and figure out what works for you. And what I mean to say is, this is what I do and what works for me. So I'm trying to tell you what I do, what I like, what has worked for me, and what hasn't. I'm not trying to preach about this is the way you have to do it, or it won't work right, or some shit like that, because I'm no expert. I just have been doing this for a long time, and so I've made a lot of mistakes, and that's mainly what I like to talk about, are the things that I've done that did not work, and why they didn't work, and what I do instead. Okay, so that being said, I mixed up 3 of these already. I mixed up the quinacrylone magenta. Oh, and that also has a little bit of this deco art rich tourmaline in it, just to give it a little spark. So when I'm mixing with some colors, like specifically for this, and see, these are Christmas ornaments, I want them to be especially bright and glitzy-like. So I did put in the magenta, I added this, and in the green, which was Artist Loft's deep green, I added this deco art emerald, just a little bit, you know, like a tablespoon or something. Maybe, yeah, about a tablespoon. Because the quantity of paint in each one of these size cups is about 2 tablespoons or 2.5 tablespoons total. So maybe a tablespoon, maybe more like 2 teaspoons. I'm not real good with spatial stuff, and I do not measure. So I'm just kind of throwing that out there. I know it would be easier for y'all if I could, maybe it would be easier, I don't know, if I could say 1 tablespoon emerald green, 1 tablespoon deep green, 1 tablespoon, you know, I'm not doing that. I eyeball it, and you can eyeball it too if you get used to learning what works. You know, that measuring stuff, I start to feel like I'm cooking. And I love to cook sometimes. if I'm in the mood for it. And I have people that want to eat. But cooking for one, cooking for me and my son is really an exercise in futility, so I don't do it very often. And this is supposed to be artistic and fun and free. So there's something that conflicts there to me with people who want to specifically measure out to every drop everything they put in there. To me, that doesn't feel freeing. It doesn't feel cathartic. It feels robotic, and I don't like it. Constraining, that's how it feels. And I don't like it, so I don't do that. So I'll tell you as best I can. In this cup, I've got about 3 tablespoons of paint. This one right here, the red, I didn't go over. When I want a true red, like the red, the one I go to is this Master's Touch Permanent Red. I like it better than any of the other ones. I do also like the Master's Touch Thick Body. This is Naphthol Crimson. I like that one. I like some of those. But that primary red is what I usually go to when I want a true red. And look at how beautiful it is. I mean, you can see that is red red, you know, blood red. Okay, now, so those are already mixed up. And now I'm going to talk about how I did that. If I'm going to be needing to mix two colors together or several colors together to get the hue that I want, I want to do that before I add any glue or any Floetrol or anything else to it. Never, ever, if you can help, and I'm saying that here because if you can, and you can help, don't ever try to blend your hue with all of those additives in there, because it's very time consuming, it's really hard to do, and you've already got a whole batch of whatever color that turns out to be. So the thing to do is put your paint, I feel stupid even saying it because it seems like common sense, but put your paint in first. And if you're going to mix several colors of paint, mix them first before you add anything to it. That way, if you need to change it, you can do it very succinctly that way. If you add all of these additives to it, it's going to change it. And then it's harder to manipulate the hue. Okay. The other thing is if I'm going to need to add any water, and the only time I add water is on some of these metallics. Like, for instance, this is my go-to gold, Deco Art. And it is the best gold that I've ever used. They have a couple of versions. This one is just, it says gold. Some of my, there's another one I think that says true gold or something like that. Anyway, I love this. But it is really thick, and so I want to add just a smidgen of water, maybe like less than a tablespoon, maybe a fourth a tablespoon of water, just enough where I can get the consistency of it in the cup to equal the consistency of my regular paints. Same thing goes for this burgundy here. Okay, this is a beautiful burgundy. When I want a really pretty garnet burgundy color, this is what I use, the DecoArt Americana Deco Metallics. Bright metallic paint. It's in the same area at Hobby Lobby where you buy these. And it's beautiful, it's wonderful, but you do have to dilute it just a little bit. I'll show you how much I use. And I just use tap water. Some people get all hairy about that. They want to use distilled water. Go ahead if that's what you want to do. I have not seen any ill effects from just using tap water. There's so little of it involved. Really, folks. I mean, I don't think it matters. But if you feel OCD-ish about that, then go ahead and satisfy your OCD, okay? Now this, you want to give them a stir before you use them because they get kind of sitting up, but look at how beautiful that is. It's like spun gold. So I take like a big old blob and another big old blob, and then I kind of look, see what I got. I'm going to add a little more because I'm going to fill this pretty high. So that's about, there was a little bit already in here. So, see, that's about 3 tablespoons of paint. Now, this is already diluted a little bit because there was paint already in here before, but I'm going to add just a little bit of water. Watch how much. There. Just a tad. And go ahead and mix it. Now, if you happen to add too much, if it's runny or it's a lot looser than your other paints, you can always just add a little bit more paint to it. You know, just a dab more paint will, you know, will even that out. Now this is going to be kind of like this. It'll run off the spoon, but just barely. It's pretty thick. Because I think the mix for doing these balls needs to be kind of thick. Otherwise, it just runs straight off. You know, thick, maybe a little thicker even than if I was doing a pour painting, okay? Most of the time, I use the same mix for my pours. But I would say that this is even a little thicker by virtue of the paint to fluid ratio. In other words, I use a little more paint, a little less fluid with these because I want them to be somewhat thicker. If this was for, well, let's finish it and I'll tell you. Okay, let me put the lid on that good. And just so you know, these things will stick, the lids, on here really bad. If that happens, whack it on the side of the table real hard. Or get a big spoon and whack around the edge. It works for glass jars of pickles and stuff like that. It also works for these. Because I find that happens all the time and then you can't get into them. And it's very frustrating. Now this one here, there's a little bit of paint already in here from my last pour. But I'll show you. I'm going to mix it to get all that good stuff started up. And then I'm going to put a big blob. Probably just one more blob in this one because it already had some in there. Okay. Now, this one will need to be thinned, but just a little bit because it already had some in there. So just, you see that, just a tad bit. And then you go ahead and mix for several reasons. Number one, if you put all of that stuff, your glue and your Floetrol in here with the paint, and then you try to add water, you're going to slosh it all over the place. The water will just slosh out of the thing on the top. The other reason is it's easier to mix the water into the paint if you do it in small amounts. The water and the paint are not going to want to mix. And if you do it in a small amount, you can mix it and you can see that it's mixed. Now see, this one's a little bit thick, a little bit less thick. I'll take that back. It's about the same as my gold. And that's good. Now, to these other three that are not metallic, I did not add any water. About 3 tablespoons of paint, about a heaping teaspoon of glue, Elmer's White School Glue. Do not try the clear. You will be disappointed. And I put a big, I hate the word dollop, but that's pretty much what it is. Watch this. Like that. Just that first big blob that comes out. You don't need a whole lot. I don't know what exactly it is about the glue that helps, but the PVA works. Okay, and then I stir this up a little bit. You don't have to get crazy and make sure it's like, you know, all totally mixed, but I just give it a little stir just because it makes stirring the whole thing easier. If you stir it increments, it helps. Now here's the Floetrol. Y'all all know Floetrol, okay? I put that in last, almost last, and I'm gonna add, I'll show you. Well, up to about the edge of Floetrol. So you can judge for yourself. Some of y'all are spatial thinkers. You can tell how much that was. See how high up it comes? Almost to the top. All right. Now, in mixing these, because of these containers, I have to kind of start in the middle and work my way outward. It's got a little ledge on the inside of this cup. And I don't want... You need to be aware of that, of the landscape of your cup. If it does have a ledge or a step on the inside, be sure you scrape that real good because I have left paint in places because I wasn't taking into account the terrain of the bottom of the cup, so to speak. Now, this is how long I mix. Y'all can mix for however long you want, but the first few pour strokes are just getting the paint off the container, and then after that, I just want to be sure it's blended real well. Be sure you do the edges, because that Floetrol will adhere to the edge, and then when you go to pour your paint out, you'll see a little line of white, and that's because you didn't get all the Floetrol off the edge. So that's it. For metallics, a little water. For regular acrylic paints, no water. Every now and then you get a certain color of acrylic paint that's a little thicker. Sometimes I find it with orange for some reason. And you might want to add some water. It's not about the kind of paint or the color or anything like that. It's about the consistency. You know, what consistency do you have? Now, see, these now will run off the spoon, as will these. In fact, that right there is a little bit thicker than this, but it's okay. I'm not getting real crazy about consistency as far as long as they're pretty close. And those are close. Yeah. Those are real close. That might be a little bit thicker, but it's okay. But I do want to alter the metallics. If you're using this DecoArt Gold and this Burgundy, these particular ones, all metallics are going to be heavier than your regular paints because of the mica pigment that's in metallics. That's a powdery substance, so it's going to make them thicker anyway. But these particular ones, this DecoArt Gold and Burgundy, tend to be, especially the gold, extremely thick. So you don't want it too thick. Now, as for our Friend Flow treadmill oil, I love the treadmill oil. I use it in everything. I use a lot of it. All right, see this? This is how much. I just almost count to two. I see no problem with that. Now, an experiment might be to try not using any in these, because I think sometimes it wants to make cells and it'll cause an open place in your ball. Like a cell will go all the way down through into the glass and you'll have an open space. I have seen that. So I have considered not using it, but I just can't seem to leave it behind. I don't know why, okay? I have cut out how much I use, because in a regular pour painting, I will put it in the cups like that. And then I'll put it in my pour cup, the cup I'm going to layer in. I'll put it in the bottom of that. And then I'll layer it on the top of my pouring cup before I pour it. So I use a lot of it. And I have cut that down. Now, here's a big important thing for this and for just acrylic pour painting in general. Once you add that treadmill oil, do not overstir it. It will break down. Okay, it'll be as if you never put it in there at all if you overstir. And by overstir, I mean what you need to do is this. Go around the edge, I circle into the middle, just like that, about that many times. And because these are real thick, I did it more than I normally do. If I was doing this for a pour painting, maybe three swipes around, that's it. Because it will degrade in there, and it will be as if you had not. Now, I have seen people, accomplished people on YouTube, stir the absolute hell out of the paint after they've added the treadmill oil. Please don't. You will, do it and see what happens. You know, don't take my word for it. If you want to do it, do it. But what I think you'll find is that you will have more cells if you stir it less. And I know for some of us, you know, it might bother you to see it floating on the top and not have it all mixed in there real good. You know, don't. It bothers me not to add it to this cup, but I'm not going to, because I don't want those cells to become so prevalent that they eat their way through to the bottom of the ball. And this batch I made right here has got some little places where I can see the ball. And that might be why. It might be a place in the glass where it just didn't adhere as good. I don't know. All I know is treadmill oil makes cells. Cells are layers through the paint. And if they layer deeply enough, they will come to the glass. And then you'll have an open blotchy place that you don't want. So I do like the effect that the cells give, so I put a little bit. But normally I would squirt a bunch in here to cover the bottom. I'd layer my paint, and then I'd squirt some on the top of this cup before I pour it. For an acrylic pour paint, I would. But I'm not doing that on these. Okay, make that clear. On these, I just add a little bit to each cup, and, well, I add a good bit to each cup, but who's, you know, is somebody quantifying out there? Anyway, okay. Now, as far as these colors now, like I said, I tried to mix just the brightest. The darkest color on here is that burgundy, and I was ambivalent about using it, but it looked so pretty, I went ahead and did it. I had copper in there and even some bronze at one time, and I found it was just browning it up too much. So I don't know if it was the colors or if it was the fact that there were just too many colors involved. So I've cut this down. I would say I would not suggest using more than 4 or 5 colors for these, because I think more than that and it's gonna muddy. You know, you do what you, you know, if you're like me, you wanna put all the colors in. I love all the colors. I wanna use every shade of green and red that I have. I wanna put the silver, the copper, the bronze. You know, I wanna do that, but I can't do that because that will turn to mud. And some of these, after they've dried, they look muddier than they did. They're gonna look somewhat dimmer once they dry anyway. And just remember that when you put the shine stuff on them, they'll brighten back up. If they don't brighten back up when you put the shine stuff on, then you have mud and you need to redo it. All right, so we got this. Let's see. I like to go in order, like a pattern, a cycle. That's just the OCD in me. You can do it however you want. I would make this suggestion. I don't suggest doing 2 different colors of green together, 2 different colors of red together. I like to mix the red and the green. You know, red, green, gold, red, green, burgundy, red, green. You know what I'm saying? Don't do red, red, green with different shades. It's going to look like red, green, you know. It's not going to show your burgundy and your pink and your gold if you layer different hues of the same color on top of each other. You're going to waste paint. It's going to be, yuck. Anyway, all right, I'll start with the pink here. Or the quinacridone magenta, whatever you want to call it. Now, I put enough to cover the bottom for the first color. Now, after that, for these balls, normally for an acrylic pour, I would pour down the side and I would put enough in to almost cover the bottom on top of each color. Each layer would be that much paint. For these, I do less. Because, think about it, if you're pouring this over a ball and you've got big swatches of each color, you're going to get big swatches of each color on your ball, and that's not what you want. You want the colors to be intertwined and mixed together. So I cover the bottom with that first one, and that's that bright pink. So I'm going to go with this green on top, and I'll show you how much I'm going to put. I can't do it while I'm pouring, but I'll show you right after. I almost count to 2. See that? Just that much. And it kind of rode up on the side. But I almost count to 2. And that's how I count, I don't measure, but that's how I kind of think about it. Watch this, okay? Just a little dab, okay? See that? Because that way when they pour out, they'll be more variegated. Okay, let's go with some real red on top of that. Gold. And I don't necessarily pour all the way down the cup. Now, here's another experiment I'm going to try. I pour down the side of the cup about halfway, and then I kind of will pour all over the middle. I don't know why. It's just what I do. But, all right, let's do some green on top of that red, and then we'll do burgundy. Okay. I'm going to do an experiment and try layering them on top of each other instead of pouring down the side. I'm going to try that. I haven't tried it yet. I've just started this project, so that batch right there is my first product. And like I told you in the beginning video, I'm still kind of working the kinks out of it. I'm not thoroughly happy with my results yet, but I am happy with my I'm pretty happy with my technique. Like I said, there's some things that I'm thinking about tweaking a little bit, like that layering instead of pouring down the side thing. You know, I'm considering trying that. Because I've been doing it about halfway up, I'll just arbitrarily start pouring all over the middle of it. But I'm not going to do that this time because I want to know what the difference is. This time I'm just going to layer down the side and we'll see what happens. And then the next time we will pour across the center, just layer it one color on top of the other. And we'll see how we feel about the difference in those balls. But for this one, we'll just pour down the sides. But like I said, only small amounts at a time, or else you're gonna get big layers of color on your, a ball is a small surface to cover. And if you have big amounts blobbed in there of one color on top of another, you won't have much variation in what comes out on your balls. They're gonna be monochromatic to some extent. I mean, monochromatic at a time, so to speak. I get tangled up in my words sometimes. Y'all just try to bear with me. It's just one of those things. All right, let's see. I like the way this pink looks with that green. And it kind of adds a little spark to it. You know, it's a little something different than just regular old green and red. You know, it gives it a hey there kind of. All right, I like to finish with green and red and gold. And I'm not going to pour this one all the way to the top because I only have a couple of balls out there that are ready. Now, I am, like I said, going to forego putting my treadmill wheel on top of this like I normally would. Now, let me see if I can release you from here without causing a problem. All right, let's flip you up. All right, see that? See how concentric those are and how much paint? See how much of that gold I put in there that last time? Maybe a tablespoon or something? I don't know. I got to unplug you too. And I'm not going to do that holding that paint because I will make a mess. All right. Golly. This making these videos just saps the battery power out of my phone. Or maybe it just needed to be charged. I don't know. Okay. Now, out here, it's going to be a little dark. Cadums. There's my cat. Cadums. Cadums. That's my cat. This is my favorite cat. Okay, now, if you notice, the three balls, we're going to do this one right up here, this top one. The three balls on the right are already colored. I'm going over them because I don't like them. There's something not right about them. Just rest assured. Now, let me see if I can hold my phone in a different way so y'all can see the angle.